Hello and welcome to the second episode about HSCT for MS. In this episode, I'll talk about what HSCT for MS is and how it works. Especially that last part, how does HSCT for MS work, turned out to be a very complicated question to answer. I read the latest literature, talked to experts, emailed authors, and it once again became extra clear what a complicated disease MS actually is and how many questions are still left unanswered. In short, HSCT for MS is a treatment for multiple sclerosis that destroys the old diseased immune system with a high dose of chemotherapy, followed by transplantation of the patient's own blood stem cells harvested before the chemo to promote recovery of the immune system. In many cases, this procedure appears to be able to cause a sort of reset of the immune system, after which acute MS inflammations no longer seem to occur. In this episode, I'll explain the HSCT procedure for MS, and I'll talk about how scientists think that its treatment works. Other relevant topics, such as for which patients the treatment seems to be most beneficial, possible side effects, and many more matters, will be discussed in future episodes. An article about HSCT for MS and its effects has recently been published by Jennifer Massey and others of the St. Vincent's Hospital in Sydney, Australia. This document is open access and therefore publicly available. I'll share a link to this paper in the description of this video. The article itself is not only a great source of information, but also contains numerous references to other relevant publications. Throughout this episode, I'll display reference numbers to scientific publications on the subject that I'm discussing. These numbers can then be looked up in the references section of Massey's paper. Immunoablation followed by HSCT has been used for over 20 years to treat various aggressive forms of autoimmune disorders. The principle has been demonstrated in animal models, and it also has been documented in case reports of patients with an autoimmune disease that developed lymphoma or leukemia and were subsequently treated with HSCT. A pivotal report about the feasibility of the use of HSCT to treat multiple sclerosis was published over 20 years ago in 1997 by Fassas. In this paper, he documents the treatment of a small group of 15 MS patients. Since then, more than 25 phase 1 and phase 2 studies have been published. And all these studies have contributed to the understanding of the role of HSCT in the treatment of MS. Hematopoietic stem cells, HSCs, or blood stem cells, are immature cells that reside in the red bone marrow. The red bone marrow is a soft sponge-like material inside of bones. And these blood-forming stem cells either multiply there to form more stem cells, or they develop into one of three subtypes of blood cells. Red blood cells, erythrocytes, that transport oxygen. White blood cells, leukocytes, that fight off infections. Or platelets, thrombocytes, that facilitate blood clotting. Stem cells differ from other cells in the body because they can differentiate into different types of cells. Hematopoietic stem cells can only differentiate into blood cells, not other cells. This means that nerve damage, in the case of MS, can therefore not be repaired by these stem cells. More detailed information about HSCT can be found on the website of the American Society of Hematology. Initially, it was thought that a stem cell transplantation from a healthy donor, an allogenic transplantation, would be the most effective form of HSCT for MS. However, a severe complication that often arises is so-called graft versus host disease, a reaction in which a transplanted immune system from the donor attacks the patient's own tissues. It turned out that an autologous hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, in which a patient is transplanted with his own stem cells, can also cause a reset of the immune system. An autologous transplantation does not cause graft versus host disease, and therefore in MS, HSCT treatment is always done with autologous stem cells. An important difference between HSCT protocols is the use of myeloablative or non-myeloablative chemotherapy. In a non-myeloablative stem cell transplantation, the bone marrow of a patient is not entirely destroyed. Myelo means bone marrow and ablative means destructive. The myeloablative treatment obliterates the bone marrow, which in turn has to grow back with the help of reinfused hematopoietic stem cells. The recovery from a non-myeloablative treatment is shorter and involves fewer risks. However, which of the two procedures is more effective is still a point of discussion among scientists. Many centers and clinical studies currently use a non-myeloablative regimen. In this video, I'll give a general overview of the HSCT procedure for the treatment of MS. An MS patient that comes to the hospital for the treatment usually has a normal amount of white blood cells roaming around in his or her blood and hardly any hematopoietic stem cells. Almost all hematopoietic stem cells are located in the red bone marrow. In this first phase, the mobilization phase, the bone marrow is stimulated to produce stem cells and to release them into the bloodstream. This is usually done by a short pulse of chemotherapy, often cyclophosphamide, followed by injections of a growth-stimulating factor for a couple of days. Now that there is a great amount of stem cells in the bloodstream, they can be harvested. For this, a tube is placed into a vein through which blood is pumped to a so-called apheresis machine. This machine separates stem cells from the blood and collects them. Through a second tube, the rest of the blood is returned to the patient. The apheresis takes about 5 hours. The harvested stem cells are prepared in a lab, frozen and saved until they can be returned to the patient. After the apheresis and a resting period, the so-called conditioning phase follows. Before the reinfusion of the harvested stem cells, the patient is treated with a high dose of chemotherapy to destroy immune cells and in some cases also the bone marrow. Different centers use different kinds of chemotherapy agents in this phase, and I'll talk more about that in another video. After conditioning, the previously harvested stem cells are thawed and returned to the patient. The actual time for infusion varies, but it typically takes about half an hour to 2 hours. The last part of the HSCT procedure is engraftment and recovery. During this time, the infused stem cells find their way back to the bone marrow and repopulate it. After the chemotherapy, patients enter a critical phase in which all blood cell counts are far below normal levels. During this period, patients are at risk of infections, so precautions must be taken to avoid any exposure to microbial pathogens. Infections during this time can cause severe complications. Therefore, antibacterial, antiviral, and antifungal drugs are given during this period. As soon as a patient's blood count surpasses a certain threshold for a couple of days, the patient can leave the hospital. If you want to know more about the HSCT procedure, the European Group for Blood and Marrow Transplantation, the EBMT, has an excellent booklet online that provides detailed information about the entire procedure. I'll link to it in the description of this video. Multiple sclerosis is a chronic disease of the central nervous system, consisting of the brain, the optical nerves, the retinas, and the spinal cord. The cause of MS is still unknown, but it is known that MS is a disease in which the myelin sheets around nerve fibers of the central nervous system are being destroyed and that the immune system plays an important role in this destruction. The body's immune system consists of white blood cells and specific proteins. T cells, a subclass of white blood cells, play an essential role in the body's defenses against pathogens. There are different types of T cells, some directly attack intruders and others, so-called regulating T cells or Tregs, produce substances that either activate or inhibit cells of the immune system. This way the Tregs restrain the immune system and prevent it from being hyperactive and attack the body's own cells, a process referred to as autoreactivity. The immune system is incredibly complex, and explaining it in detail goes far beyond the scope of these videos. If you want to learn more about it, I can certainly recommend a 3-part YouTube series of crash course about the immune system. T lymphocytes originate in the bone marrow, but they mature in the thymus, a gland situated just above the heart. The T in T cells comes from the T in thymus, just as the B in B cells comes from the B in bone marrow. In the first years of life, a person is exposed to almost all antigens that cause a cellular immune response. Later in life, the number of newly encountered antigens decreases tremendously. This causes the thymus to become less active, and after puberty, the gland slowly shrivels up. More and more scientific evidence points to the malfunction of Tregs as part of the problem of autoimmune diseases. The HSCT treatment for MS, cladribine, marketed as mavenclad, and alemtuzumab, Lemtrada, are so-called immune reconstitution therapies. These are therapies that try to bring about a so-called immune system reset through the brief destruction of lymphocytes, and in some cases the bone marrow. Such a reset seems to be able to cause a number of changes. After HSCT, the thymus becomes larger and more active, and the number of Tregs increases, and the pool of T cells diversifies. Before treatment, the immune system of an MS patient contains large groups of T cells that are all triggered by the same antigen. A couple of years after the procedure, the immune system is more diverse, and even though it's not similar to that of a healthy person, it differs significantly from how it was before the treatment. Here you can see a figure from Massey's paper in which the different colored pieces of the pie chart represent different groups of immune cells aimed at the same antigen. This could, for example, be myelin in the case of MS. 2 years after HSCT, there appears to be a lot more variation in the T cell population. So it seems that the effectiveness of HSCT is not so much dependent on the complete annihilation of all autoreactive T cells, but it's more the growth of a more diverse immune system and better working Tregs. There's a lot still unknown about the exact mechanism of many MS medications. And as long as the precise cause of MS is still a mystery, a lot of questions will remain unanswered. This is one of the reasons why scientific MS research is essential. This brings us to the end of the second episode in a series about HSCT for MS. I could easily talk many hours about the topic of this episode, but for those of you that want to know more about the subject, I'll leave plenty of resources in the description of this video. In the next episode, episode 3, I'll talk about the efficacy of HSCT, clinical studies, scientific tests, patient selection, and many more topics. If you want to know more about the other episodes that are coming up in this series, please check out the last minutes of episode 1. Thanks for watching, and if you haven't done so, please subscribe to my YouTube channel. Please also let me know how you like this episode by pressing the thumbs up or thumbs down icon. Feel free to leave questions, suggestions, and comments in the comment section below. Thanks again for watching. Until next time, bye!